in this edition of Art Loft, the Curator's Collection, Art Basel, Miami Beach, featuring Gallery Gomorzenska.
For me, it was always very important to show the relevance of classic modern art in comparison to contemporary art and what's going on today.
Waddington Custat Galleries.
It's something very rare. It's an edition of three, and we brought the sets here, especially from Miami, and it sold, so we're very pleased.
Sakima Jenkins and Company.
This piece here is a work by Kara Walker from this year, and it's called The Confectionery. And she's an artist who did a huge project in Brooklyn this summer on the waterfront.
And Peter Freeman, Inc.
Behind me, we have a piece from the mid-80s by Franz Erhard Walter, and he's a German artist. And of course, the color is just like a magnet for everybody. And it's a piece where you as the public finish the piece, so you are allowed to go in.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft, the Curator's Collection.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from WPBT2's Studio A, this is Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. Art Loft, the Curator's Collection, is a series of monthly specials inviting leading South Florida galleries, museums, and local arts innovators to curate episodes based on their artistic vision. Together, we'll discuss the selected profiles' impacts on our arts and local community. Our guest curator this week is none other than WPBT2's Manager of Arts Content, Doris Bravo. Doris, I know a lot about you already, but tell our viewers a bit about yourself.
Sure. I was born in Chile, and I came to South Florida as a baby. And ever since I went to college, I've sort of been on this nomadic lifestyle. I went to college in Chicago, and then after that, I went to Chile, but I came back to the US to study art history at the University of Texas at Austin. And that's where I got my master's degree in art history, as well as my PhD just recently in May.
Excellent. So tell us a little bit about your role here at WPBT2.
I have a really cool job here at the station. I'm the manager of arts content. So what that means is I curate the programming that we air on Art Loft. And there's a few criteria that I like to use for the people, organizations, and events that we highlight. One of them is geography. Our audience stretches from Sebastian Inlet all the way down to Key West. So I like to be able to profile the stories that happen in that area. And the second criteria is what kind of topic it is. So I like to highlight the visual arts as well as the performative arts, dance, music, theater, literary arts, and local filmmakers, because we have a really vibrant community with film. So lastly, I think the most important criteria is that it translates well to television. And that's been a really fun part of my job, is trying to see what will look good on TV, what will make for interesting television.
And I always enjoy going to a lot of the places you pick and meeting such great and interesting people. So thank you, Doris. For this month's Curator's Collection, we're shaking things up. In anticipation of Art Week and Art Basel Miami Beach 2015, this episode will focus on our time at last year's show. Art Basel Miami Beach is one of the most impressive events of the winter art season and one of my most favorite times here in Miami. But unless you've been there, you may not have an accurate grasp of the show's scale. Well, worry not. We've done the legwork for you. Here's a taste of what it's like walking Art Basel Miami Beach. Let's slow down a little bit. There's so much to discuss. Doris, you have an interesting tie to Art Basel Miami Beach. Tell us a bit about it.
I definitely do. For the past 4 years, I gave tours with Art Nexus, and it was a really wonderful experience because I was a graduate student at the time. So it allowed me to kind of take a break from my studies and just talk about art with people, which is one of my favorite things to do.
You know what's interesting? We have a little surprise. We have some footage that we found with you at the desk for your tours. There it is.
So that photograph is probably the one time that day that I had 5 minutes to like drink water and eat a granola bar.
Right, very nice. Well done, bravo.
Thank you.
First up, we visit Switzerland-based Gallery Gemergenska. Their exhibition, A Kid Could Do That, aims to disprove this oft-shared analysis on various works of art. Now, Doris, I know when I see some of these works of art, you know, like a lump of clay on the floor at Art Basel, I often think, I'm in the wrong line of business. I can do that. So what's your take on this topic?
Absolutely. I think this is a really important issue with contemporary art. What I hear when people say, well, my kid could do that, is a lot of fear as well as just misunderstanding. And what I would say is that yes, your kid probably could have done that, but there's a difference between a child making art and an adult, right? A child is sort of expressing themselves just through their subconscious and just kind of trying to make sense of the world through art, whereas an adult has had training or has some sort of skill. Now, what contemporary art shows us is that these artists are deciding to make art this way, and that's the big difference. So with the Impressionists, for example, today there's no doubt that that is like art with a capital A. 120 years ago, when that art was first exhibited, people hated it, they ridiculed it, and they thought that those Impressionist artists were not just crazy, but had some problems with their eyesight, if that's how they were looking at the world. Because up until then, art was very representational, and it was like a photograph.
Right, very realistic.
Absolutely. So these artists decided, we are gonna make art that's more like an impression, like a blur. And today, we accept it, and I think that's what's gonna happen to contemporary art, that we'll appreciate that these artists made a decision to do that, and we won't look at it so weird.
It's a beautiful perspective. Now we have A Kid Could Do That from Gallery Gemergenska.
For me, it was always very important to show the relevance of classic modern art in comparison to contemporary art and what's going on today. So when you look at the show, which is a 50-year anniversary show that we've put together with absolute masterworks, we put them in a context with a very contemporary, famous film producer and regisseur, which is Baz Luhrmann, who's just recently done The Great Gatsby. And why did we do that? We did it because he has a similar interest in rediscovering classic material, both in film and music, and bringing it in the context of a contemporary audience. So here we brought very important early 20th century pieces, put them in a classroom, not only as an educational part, but also with a playful little side kick that when you go to an art fair, most people will ask you, oh, my child could have done that painting. And the answer to that is this exhibition, why it could not have been done by a child, but also why the playful aspect has always been an important part of 20th century art. We brought one painting in particular that's there. It's a Malevich painting from 1917, which in a nutshell was the painting that basically influenced and coined a whole American movement, which is the minimalist movement of people like Ellsworth Kelly, Donald Judd, Ryman. And when you have a painting like that at an art fair, where literally every scholar comes and pays homage to this painting, you have something that sets the tone for this fair, also for the future. So that was really probably our biggest achievement for this year. This show is more than just a normal exhibition. It is really something that was carefully curated. And when you do that kind of effort, you want to have the response that people understand what you did and appreciate that. And from that point of view, it was a huge success with a lot of press. also with an educational part that is very important for this fair and for the future of modern art. So we brought a 50th anniversary show, which is museum quality paintings, to a very contemporary fair, and it has been appreciated both by colleagues of ours, which is quite an important thing, as well as by collectors and museum people.
At our next stop, we visited London-based Waddington Custot Galleries. With several large-scale pieces on view, this gallery space was very hard to miss. Doris, what specifically stood out for you?
They had a really beautiful painting sculpture by the French artist Jean Dubuffet. And he actually had a pretty long life, but he was mostly active in like around World War II, mid-century. And he was a great admirer of what we call outsider art. So it's really interesting to think about my kid could do that, because he actually really liked children's art as well as art of the mentally ill and the art of people who had not received formal training, because he thought that there was something really pure and uncomplicated about how they made art. So the reason why I like this sculpture is because it's literally his collage-like two-dimensional works in three dimensions. And they're kind of like human forms. It's a very basic color palette and white with black outlining and some splashes of blue and red. And I just think he's such a cool artist. So I was really happy to see this sculpture in the segment.
We now have Waddington Custot Galleries.
Art Basel Miami is basically a big celebration. It's a happy fair, and it's always a very exciting moment for us early December, because basically we just look forward to come here in Miami and party a little bit as well and enjoy the climate, the sea, etc. So it's a perfect compromise for us exhibitor to come and exhibit here. We brought an amazing set of numbers by Robert Indiana. It's something very rare. It's an edition of three, and we brought the set here, especially for Miami, and it sold, so we're very pleased. We also brought works by Ian Davenport, who is a British artist that we wanted to introduce to the American markets. And a very important sculpture, monumental sculpture by Jean Dubuffet. Every year is basically growing, and I personally feel like every year there's more and more and more and more to see. It looks like a very, very creative city and place, which is amazing.
Welcome back, art lovers. This edition of Art Loft is being curated by WPBT2's Manager of Arts Content, Doris Bravo. Doris, we're going to move on to Sakima Jenkins and Company. Now, their New York-based gallery had a particularly striking piece on view by Kara Walker. The means to produce this piece may be considered simple, but the end result is quite powerful. What do you think?
Oh, I absolutely agree. Kara Walker is one of my favorite artists, and it's partly because of her really impactful kind of artistic practice. So what she does is she makes cutouts of silhouettes in black paper, and she affixes them to a wall. So from far away, it's this very strong graphic that, at least for me, draws me in. And as I get closer, I realize that the scene is actually pretty violent. They're mostly violent or just grotesque. I remember seeing one where it was a person's leg cut off with blood coming out. I like her a lot because she has this really great interpretation of history, or at least a reflection of history, specifically the South around the Civil War era, and how African Americans have been depicted in American popular culture. So that comes up a lot in her work, and she's so talented. She works in a lot of media, so I was really happy to see that there was a work of hers at Art Basel last year.
Yes, I think that's why her art speaks to me, the whole civil rights and Southern connection. So let's let our viewers take a look at Sakima Jenkins and Company.
Miami Basel, it's one we've returned to since the very beginning. We've been doing it since it started, and we find it's a very lively collecting community. And for us, because we have artists from Brazil and Venezuela, Miami itself is a very international city, so we find it's a really wonderful fair for us. This piece here is a work by Kara Walker from this year, and it's called Confectionery. And she's an artist who did a huge project in Brooklyn this summer on the waterfront as part of a work that was sponsored by Creative Time. They invited her to work in the former Domino sugar processing factory. And she made a 2-foot story sphinx out of sugar with accompanying attendants, sugar boys that were covered in molasses and sugar. And it was really quite a spectacle this summer. There was just a tremendous number of visitors. It was just a fantastic, really moving, and I think tremendously successful public art project. But we really felt it was important to represent Kara here at the fair. And she's someone that we brought to the fair before, but I would say there were more people that were aware of her and her work here at the fair. I think you don't get as much of a chance to really talk to people the first few days at an art fair. It tends to be cursory, like, is that available? Let's talk about this really quickly kind of interactions. But as the week stretches out, your time does too a little bit. There's more interaction on a calmer level that we really appreciate. So.
Our next piece features a gallery with representation in both New York City and Paris, France. From their space at the show, a representative for Peter Freeman, Inc. shares their exhibited works and her insight into how Art Basel Miami Beach compares to the founding show in Basel, Switzerland, and Hong Kong's show. Doris, what's your impression of the show's international appeal?
There's something really special about Art Basel Miami Beach, and it's specifically the Latin American connection. It's a great opportunity for galleries to bring in artists from Central America, South America, and really expose them to an international audience. And as somebody who studied Latin American art history, I find that really exciting. And every year I look forward to seeing new artists as well as artists that I'm already familiar with at the fair. And they actually often come, so that's always exciting for me when I can run into them.
I know it must be great for you to see some of those artists. Now we have Peter Freeman, Inc. at Art Basel Miami Beach 2014.
The gallery has participated at the Art Basel Miami since 2002, and it has grown as a big bridge with all the Latin American countries, with Colombia, with Venezuela, with, of course, Mexico, Brazil. All the collectors and curators and a lot of public from these countries have come to Miami more and more over the years. Behind me, we have a piece from the mid-80s by Franz Erhard Walter, and he's a German artist, and of course the color is just like a magnet for everybody, and it's a piece where you as the public finish the piece, so you are allowed to go in. Of course, here at the fair, we're not allowing people to come in, especially because we sold the work. It's now in a private collection, so we would like to take care of it. We have brought a representation of the artists that we represent, or a selection of the artists that we represent. Of course, not all of the artists that we represent are here, but we always try to make a presentation of works that talk to each other. So there's a lot of planning, there's a lot of thinking ahead. We like to create the show, not only think of it as an art fair presentation, but as a small exhibition where people can learn about the artists that we represent.
Thanks so much for joining us this week. And special thanks goes to our guest curator, Doris Bravo, Manager of Arts Content at WPBT2. Thank you so much for being with us.
Sure, it was a pleasure. All I had to do was come downstairs.
Art Basel Miami Beach 2015 runs December 3rd through 6th. For more, including this year's exhibitors list, visit artbasel.com. And for a list of Art Week events, visit our events page at wpbt2.org/artloft. Once again, art lovers, it's been a pleasure. Let Art Loft inspire your creativity every day. Watch past episodes at wpbt2.org/artloft and get social with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kalyn James reminding you to stay creative. See you next time on Art Loft, the Curator's Collection. Bye. Bam, way to go. High five.
Okay. All right.
Yes. Ooh, your hands are freezing.
I know.
Lord have mercy.
I have low blood pressure.
So. Hold your hands. God bless your soul. My God, they're like ice.
I don't give blood because they think I'm like a zombie. They're like, they're like, are you alive? I'm like, I made it here, man. I'm like, I'm here.
I was like, and so. What? What did I do?
I lost my train of thought.
Let's do it. I'm ready. Yeah, roll. Let's knock this baby out the park. I've got sleep to do. I mean,
you know, it's just whatever. Like, I'm obviously wearing a mic. Like, surprise. At everybody's talk, whenever I see them on TV, and I'm like, where do they have it? Like, B-roll. Look at that B-roll. Is that politically incorrect? I think it might be. It's
politically incorrect.
It's politically incorrect. I firmly believe this. But, oh, sorry. I'm distracted by the...
Yeah. Sorry. I'm like... Oh, God, no! No!
Not ready.
Kill me now!
Ah! Like, do I do, like, a wave or...
Don't do that. No. Adio! Thanks for joining. This goes to Doris Bravo, Arts Content Manager at WPBT2. Thank you so much for being with us.
Sure, it was a pleasure. All I had to do was come downstairs.
Makes it easy. I don't know where it is. Donate to Art Loft and win a trip with Kalyn, the curator. Mentally insane.
We had a couple of frog attacks.
What?
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and
in the Florida Keys in Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida.